That's right. Oh. All right, go, Jason.
It's
go.
Bill.
30 minutes. The timer's on.
All right.
That's my beer.
I know.
Go. Jason, what did you think
of the book? Who liked the book?
I'm not going to say I appreciated the book. I appreciated the writing. I really appreciated the ending because I did not see that coming. I did not see who actually murdered him.
That's
coming.
True.
So okay. That I greatly appreciated. And I appreciated the way it tied into the main character, how she killed her mother, and then the main character is killed in the same way. Did not see that coming. So I always appreciate a good writer who, like, leads me through. At times I thought it was a little didactic, a little, like,
preachy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I did love her, Molly. I felt like I got an insight into someone that is Asperger's or on the spectrum and doesn't see...
Excuse me, Patty, it's neurodivergent.
Doesn't take cues like we all do from people's facial expressions or from their words that they say. And I felt like it was kind of cool for me to be able to be in her person. And I actually kind of started feeling like her. I feel you, Molly!
Woo! Oh, boy.
Okay, great.
Great time.
All right. Well, we
I think Molly's interesting, but who knows?
Who among all of us knows somebody who's neurodivergent?
No, I don't. Well, my brother says he is, and sometimes I feel I am. I think there's a spectrum. I think I lie right here in the middle.
I would like to know what a person who is neurodivergent thinks about this book.
Oh, that's right. Great, yeah.
I would like to know, I was going to look into this woman's background and how does she presume to know how this woman thinks?
Well, she taught special. She okay. taught special ed.
Yes,
but,
she did.
Okay, I didn't know that.
She did. She was exposed to children.
For a little bit. She didn't do it for very long.
Yeah, and I don't feel the characters were consistent. At times it felt like, but then again, I don't know. I don't know much about that. So
I thought she was very...
But did you read the reviews? Because there are people out there that have neurodivergent children, their parents.
Uh-huh.
And they weren't particularly, I mean, it was a book and they read it, but they weren't particularly positive about it. You know, I would say totally negative, but
they
didn't really like it. I mean, they said, you know, this is not my child. This is not the way people are.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know because I've been around some neurodivergent people and I appreciated the stilted speech, but I and the thinking was kind of interesting. But like you guys say, how do you know? How do you?
It's a spectrum,
right?
Yeah, but how do you create a person? That's all we're talking about. We're talking about a person that we're going to develop as a character and make her consistently neurodivergent. And I don't know if that happens.
I thought she was very consistent.
I don't know. I mean, I don't have any...
Yeah, I don't know if she was consistent because I don't know many people that way. She didn't seem consistent.
Right, so there's two things going on here. One is the character development of a neurodivergent main character, and then there's the plot that involves all these other people, and for somebody's first novel, that's quite a project.
There's going to be a sequel. Did you know that?
There already is.
Yes. A movie.
There already is.
A movie.
There's going to be a movie?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They've already cast somebody.
And who?
I'd never heard of before. Okay.
But there's already a series. But she's already written the second novel on the series.
And this is going to turn into like a mystery series, really, probably, right? Where Molly...
Right.
She keeps getting exposed to murder.
Yeah. Well, everybody keeps...
I think like you only get one.
Yeah, exactly. on the reviews, everybody keeps talking about Monk.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought that was unfair. Because we're now neurodivergent people have a consistent kind of behavior. And Monk is different. And Molly is different. And they're completely different people.
But Molly and her grandma let
me. Doesn't matter.
Is Columbo and Monk the same guy?
No.
No.
So I don't know.
In the Kindle version, Columbo. They give you the first chapter of the mystery game. And it goes on to explain to Molly. No, I think
where was that
in the book?
Right.
Yeah. In the book they like Columbo, but on the comics they like
this a Kindle.
They talk about Monk.
But I mean, Molly's like I think the head of the whatever.
Yeah,
you know.
She got promoted.
Monk was obsessive compulsive.
Right.
Has anybody besides me watched the series Atypical?
Oh,
has
no.
Anybody what?
Oh, it's great. We're inundating you with shows to watch. But it's called Atypical. I think it's on Netflix.
Okay.
Amazon. It's about a teenager. I mean, it's on for 4 or 5 seasons. And he grows up. He's a teenager. He's in high school at the very beginning. But it's about his family and how they deal with him. And I'm sure the actor that plays him is not autistic. But, you know, he's very bright. He has a job. He has a girlfriend, eventually, in the show. He has sex. He does all these things. He's obsessed with penguins. That's his thing. He goes to the aquarium and watches them. He notices when they get sick and Fred is sick. I need to do something about it. And this kind of, it's really a nice, heartwarming series.
So there's penguin sex in this series?
Yeah. No,
not penguin sex.
He has sex.
Oh.
Not with the penguin.
Okay. But you never see it.
What's it called, Jeff?
Atypical.
And it's a show on Netflix?
It's a series.
But not a book.
It has at least 3 seasons, maybe.
And you've watched it.
Yeah.
But you haven't read the book.
I didn't think there was a book.
But I'm just a total newbie. I mean, not even a newbie. But Pam has people come in to her facility that are challenged and to do projects because they need projects to do. And she described to me an individual that was so overcome with the concept of doing something that he had to lay down on the couch and just calm. And so I went over to meet Pam to do something, and I was walking out and there was this individual on the couch laying there because he needed to be calm. And I'm going to myself, how in the hell? Because there are more and more of these people and less of us. How in the hell? How in the hell do you compensate? You manage? How do these people, how do you inculcate these people into society? Because he was on the couch.
They've been around. They've always been there, Jason. It's not like all of a sudden.
Right. We have.
You mean like witches?
Yes. We have exactly.
Like gay people. They were always there. They just
what? What?
I just need to tell you something else about Atypical was that after the first season, they got a lot of criticism because the guy who plays this dude, he's not. Atypical. And from then on, the next seasons, his classmates, they actually have some Asperger and autistic people playing his classmates in school. So that's amazing.
And it's great. And I was under the impression, though, that brains are getting wired in different ways and that there are going to be more brains operating like that.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Where's my responsibility? Do I need to think like them, or do they need to think like me?
I don't know if they just need to accept them where they are.
Impossible of both ways.
it's going to be a cultural challenge because the brains are wired.
Right, exactly.
The brains are wired differently.
I mean, we're all wired for something.
Right. It's very trendy to be autistic right now.
And then there's that.
Well, but, talking about is Down syndrome.
TV shows with autistic detectives are
doctors.
Yeah. I mean, they're everywhere.
And they can't have a show without having
somebody on the
spectrum.
Well, it's about time.
But we have the kids that we have are from Center for Developmentally Disabled, and they are doing a summer work program. And the person in his thing is he has Down syndrome, and so you aren't going to change him. You're going to meet him where they are, and you're going to learn to cope. Just like he has to come in every morning when he's not on the couch and give everybody a hug, and so he hugs, and then he sits back and he runs his hands through your hair. And then I go, JR, I need my personal space. But he got in, he fell in love with a stuffed animal in one of the case manager's office, and we had to like pry him out. And he came out with the stuffed animal. But he invaded, you know, case management meeting. So the people who are working with him from CDB aren't very well trained. And I'm not trained either, but you know, we just have your boundaries. But that's who he's talking about. So it's not an autistic child. It's a developmental disability that he's not going to overcome, and you're not going to change. You're going to accept him how he is, and he's never probably going to be able to have a job. He's going to take those times where he's on the couch several times, and I mean, he's getting paid because this is his job.
I think that's my biggest objection with the book. Is that Molly was, if I remember it
high
right,
functional.
Well, she was so accepting of all of these the other people and the way
her
they
grandma.
Treated her. You know,
her
like,
grandma taught
she,
her that.
She was like, I would think an autistic person would be a little critical of all these little aspects that are external to her and would push back a lot, but in this book, it seemed like to me, it was like, well, they don't understand what I said, and I'm okay with that. And then moved from second to second, it seemed like she was reacting in a, you know,
to me, that'd be some of the inconsistency.
Yeah, because she never lied. I thought
the same thing, but I was wondering if it wasn't gender specific, because, I mean, most of her contacts were male. And so, as a female...
No, Giselle was she loved Giselle.
I know, but I'm just saying.
And she loved Graham.
I'm just saying, there's if you really dive into this novel, there's a hell of a lot of shit going on. I mean, I have no idea how to sort it all out. I'm just saying.
What just occurred to me when you said that, it's almost like there was too much going on.
Right.
Like, what a brilliant mind. And yet, there's too much going on.
I mean, a book that you think that a book supports, a book sorts it all out, so that at the end of the book you feel like the project is complete. You've sorted things out.
And you didn't feel that?
Not necessarily. In the sense that there's so much going on. I mean, there's gender. There's neurodivergent. There's murder. There's the murder.
Addiction.
Right. I mean, there's a for a first novel. There's a lot going on.
Okay. One of the inconsistencies I agree with Barbara about is when she stole the ring.
I was like, no. Polly would not be
the father. And then just goes right on down the street to
wait.
The thing.
A woman who cannot lie.
She was,
and she steals a ring.
Until she didn't steal it.
And knows it
her
immediately where to go with it.
Rat was due.
How is it she knows where to go?
She cannot tell a lie, but she doesn't have to tell a whole truth. I mean, she saw the woman, the wife, But she never disclosed that at all. So, I mean, it's like, that to me was a big hole. It was like, oh, well, that's a good ending because it came in from nowhere. But why didn't she disclose it? Yeah, they didn't tell us.
Did she not tell the police or anybody else? She didn't tell us either.
Yeah.
Well, however, the one way that may have worked for me is the fact that acknowledging that this woman, that she killed her husband, would be acknowledging that she killed her husband. And so for me, there was like...
She killed the what?
Her grandma.
Her mother. How did she kill her grandma?
She suffocated.
Suffocated.
Yeah, she suffocated.
Oh, God, I forgot now.
Are you saying that? I missed
Molly,
that too.
Molly
suffocated her grandmother.
Oh, when she was
at the very last minute. At the very last minute. And her grandmother begged her to do it.
Okay, yeah.
Sorry. The grandmother, they had a pact. Right. And Molly said, I don't want to do this, but her grandmother made me pass.
Okay, go ahead.
So for me, that's why I never told the police,
said Molly,
that the ex-wife killed him because I would be acknowledging that she did. Yeah.
To her Molly.
So there was a little, at least a sense of, I could see why she didn't do that. But there was that.
Well, I mean, I kind of thought of it as She's killed her grandma,
yeah.
And she's absorbed that into something that's okay and helps somehow. Here's this person over here that has done exactly the same thing, so why should I interfere?
Well, that's why she protected Giselle.
I'm afraid I'll be guilty.
Well, by the way, that's why she protected Giselle and the ex-wife, because she now knows that some people should be killed.
I mean, she's not.
Like Trump.
Well, she doesn't.
Like Trump, Putin, and
Bill. Bill, I'm here for you. I want you to call me every morning when you wake up. I want you to give me a call.
I mean, why did she kill him? What was the motive?
He was just an asshole.
Her husband. Oh, well, no. He was burning. One with a cigarette.
Oh, that's true.
He was cocaine.
And
oh my God, he was a bad guy.
Wasn't he abusing their children too? I think she said something about that.
There were bruises, lots of bruises.
He was a bad guy.
Yeah, she's an asshole. I mean,
yeah, worse than that. He was abusive to Janelle. Yeah, right. Okay. All
right. So he deserves that.
Yeah. So that's okay.
There's a lot going on in that. How
book.
We should be making these judgments on a human level.
Yes.
And not always relying on the system that we should be making these decisions on.
Well, yeah, but here's the thing. It's not a secret, but I mean, the fact that she's neurodivergent means that she can skip over a lot of the emotional, legal guilt stuff, to me, in terms of the author. And so she...
And see, to me, that would be the opposite. She would not be able to...
Right, she would not be able
to... Yeah, I don't know.
Did Monk?
And I can see Monk.
None of us know how neurodivergent feels. But they built a character.
He does.
And so we have to only go on how she built the character.
Right.
That's the only.
I don't know. Way not that.
Well, how you get?
Yeah.
Well, okay. So she's like. So at the very beginning, it was like, okay.
I didn't even think of that. But at the end, when there's a murder, and she sees the murderer,
she goes, okay.
He was obsessive compulsive.
So maybe that's
totally different in my mind.
I don't know.
He's not. Yeah, he's not. None of him is. No, he's obsessive compulsive. That's different than. He just had a cleaning issue.
I think that all personalities are totally different, and the author couldn't get us all the emotions maybe to fit.
Well, what was so the what was the term that you used for Molly?
I don't understand why she thought.
Did they ever use it anywhere in the book?
No.
Was that just a term we came up with tonight?
She wouldn't have ever labeled herself that she killed.
And I don't know that anybody else did.
there were some things that
she's weird.
I think she was actually pretty smart.
Yes, yep. She says early in the book
facial expressions. She should be societal as far as what's accepted in society, but don't you think it's odd that she was in the courtroom
and they would ask her questions.
Okay, we gotta have one.
And she would reply yes or no.
In the court.
In the court, yes or no, and it would sort out the case, and she would have no guilt or
She was telling the truth. She left out a little minor detail.
Right, exactly. Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
So, darling, what you need to know is she killed somebody and she lied. So you
exactly.
She told the truth about what happened and to the murder.
And she lied.
Right, and which goes back to
She never lied. Did she lie or did she leave out the truth? She did not lie. She left out the truth.
It goes back to what John Jenner
A lie of omission.
So what we need to know is that for Patty, if you omit something,
once again, Bill, I fear for your safety.
Don't you know I ask for forgiveness?
I'm worried.
You knew that about me, buddy.
I'm worried about Bill. And we're all here, and I'm worried about Bill.
Can he move in
with you? I'm just saying.
Hey, can he move in with you? Because no, really,
so,
yes.
There's a lot of in this story. Did you guys read the part where she talks about it being clues being a big part
it's
of
been my dream
how right. the right. game Clue
right.
was a big part of how she wrote this.
Oh, no.
I need another
like
one.
Mr. Plum.
Yeah,
and,
I did it in the library with a knife.
I mean, you kind of see some of that stuff in there.
Yeah.
And for me, the concept of truth is a big theme because one of the things in chapter 14 is when she... her grandmother asks her, why didn't you just tell the truth right away to your teacher, to me, to anyone? Then she cried and embraced me with such force that I was never able to answer a question. But I had an answer. I did. I didn't tell the truth because the truth hurt. What happened at school was bad enough, but Gran, knowing about my suffering, meant she experienced my pain too. That's the trouble with pain. It's as contagious as a disease. It spreads from the person who first endured it to those who love them most. Truth isn't always the highest ideal. Sometimes it must be sacrificed to stop the spread of pain to those who love.
And to me, that is pretty weird for somebody who cannot identify with the way other people feel.
Right, right. Exactly.
And so, it's an ethical statement, though. Who gets to decide, which she also mentions at the end of the book, who gets to decide what truth is and what you do to what justify
it's a pretty advanced thought.
It's philosophical. I wanted to finish my thought, but I guess I won't.
But you're right.
It's justifying. It's using truth to justify behavior.
Exactly.
Which is an interesting.
But if you Google this book and the reviews and all that, that quote is pulled up a lot.
Yeah.
But it's pulled up out of context, and you don't know before and you don't know the after. And it's the before and after that makes all the difference for that quote. Because otherwise it sounds like it's a pure thing.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the way it is, and that's not true.
Yeah, because that's important.
It's not true.
Why that happened was she was being bullied.
Exactly.
And then in the epilogue, I thought there was a very intriguing her definition of the truth.
Right.
Of what truth is. The way I interpreted it is that we all get to interpret our own truth. Well, there's truth, there's facts, and who can, does the dead man get to decide?
But when I was reading this, I thought, I don't know if anybody's read this, but, when they talk about, like, a automobile accident and the spectators around the accident or some kind of event, everybody has an impression of the event, and not everybody's impression coincides for the truth of the event. And that's exactly what I saw here. It's like she just grabbed onto somebody who was there and saw something and took that out. And so it could be one of any one of 10 or 15 people.
Who actually got pinned for the murder? Juan?
The guy, no. The
bartender.
But he didn't kill her. So his...
But he was a drug dealer.
He was a drug dealer.
And he
didn't kill her.
And he hurt Molly.
Is that right?
In Molly's mind.
So by the way, they never pinned him. It was a preliminary court hearing. They have not actually gone through.
Yeah, but they need you to believe that he's the one who's going to get pinned for this crime.
Not if he has a good lawyer.
And you know all about that, sweet girl.
Hey, that's another book.
You can get away with anything.
Maybe that's in the second one.
I mean, she's obviously like a movie hero that she developed specifically for a movie. Because this just went straight from a book to a movie. So...
Are we going to find out that she didn't really write this book? Like, what's his name? The Oprah guy. She didn't write this book. Maybe not.
For the first time.
AI wrote this book.
I thought it was really interesting. But, you know, for all our criticisms, this is a person who does nothing but criticism on other authors. And so I was fascinated by the fact that you see all these holes in it, and she sees all the holes in all the others. You know? How can she not write a better book?
Jason really got it going. We accidentally got the large print version. And everything Grandma says was in bold-faced type. And I was so sick of Grandma by the time this book was done. I was like, oh my gosh.
Just shut up.
All right, okay.
He's got to go outside. He's got to turn the music up pretty loud.
It was a good choice. That's an interesting book.
Yeah, it was.
Oh, yeah, it was. Very interesting.
Yeah. Entertaining.
A lot to think about.
Turn it off.
We don't know where it is. It's all we're good at this music, right?
Oh, Bill, make it stop.
I don't know. I don't know that you could hear it anyway. But we have 1 minute to go.
Who wants to take the last minute?
Yeah.
So who liked the book?
What do you think Jim thought of this book?
I'll say and 6 out of 10.
6 out of 10.
I think Jim didn't like the book. I think Julia liked the book.
Are you just guessing? Are you guessing?
I'm guessing.
Okay.
But Jim picked it, right?
Right.
Well, yeah, because there were two other books.
Right.
But they never told you what
it was. I like the ending though. It's like somebody in the shadow, and you just go, and you talk to a shadow, and you go, were you here? No. I wasn't here either. We won't talk about this. We'll never see each other. Yeah, we're good. I mean, what a great conclusion to a book. Like, fade out, scene over.
What do you give it? What do you rate it?
6 or 7.
All right.
6 or 7.
What do you rate it, Ross?
I rate it a... I will rate it a...